The Boundless Expanse, an epic system apocalypse lit RPG. By Debossan Barrigin Prologue. In a dark and distant corner of the multiverse, two men sat at a table in a dingy dive bar. Neither of them were human. One of them possessed skin of a monochrome gray color, whereas the other one was at complete odds with his surroundings, a rainbow-colored being with a bright ruff of feathers around his neck. Even without taking in these features, there was something different about the men. Something that made them special. Everyone within that galactic sector could feel the pressure from their presence, a nameless dread coupled with a faint desire to abase oneself before the force of something far above them. This was not the intention of the men, merely an unfortunate side effect of their presence. If either of them wished it, that sector, along with the rest of the universe, would be nothing but ash and ruins. "Did you bring the item?" the rainbow-colored man asked his companion. In response, the other man pulled out a nondescript bag from his pocket and opened it immediately. The solar system that they resided in was blasted into oblivion simply by the photons coming out of the bag. Photons were not supposed to have mass, but at such concentrations, most things could not withstand them. As promised, the solar core of a B-ranked sun. This thing was a pain in the ass to get. "I hope you have the payment with you." The gray-skinned man thrust out his hand in expectation, and the other man dropped something into it. The gray-skinned man clenched his fist around the opalescent orb, tucking it away quickly. "A pleasure doing business with you," he said before vanishing as if he had never been there. The rainbow-colored man looked around him, chuckling softly. The surrounding space, for billions of miles in every direction, was completely gone. In its place, the transchromatic colors of exotic energies, energies that had no place in such a weak universe, glittered brightly. It was almost sad, seeing how limited the existence that the majority of the inhabitants of the multiverse were forced to live in. Above all else, he pitied the inhabitants of the universe that he had just sold to the other man. The weak were nothing more than the playthings of the strong, and both men were incredibly strong indeed. He left the universe behind, scattering his essence into the ether and reforming in the space between the universes. As he sped off, back to his own universe, the one behind him imploded with a burst of light and heat, corrupted by the B-rank solar energy of the sun. Chapter 1. Sam sighed as he stared listlessly out of the window of his beat-up car. He had experienced this so many times over the last few years, a feeling of hopelessness and complete ennui. He couldn't even bring himself to blame the things that were truly at fault here, his refusal to do anything about it, and his complete lack of self-confidence. He banged his fist down on the car door, but his heart wasn't really in it. Sam withdrew his fist, examining it as he did so, and opened the car door. "Well, I might as well get to it sooner rather than later," he said as he looked at the door of Ron's diner. He had worked there for far too many years, although any amount of time in that establishment, whether as a customer or a worker, was probably too much. It was a run-down establishment, one with few staff and even fewer customers. A realm of dancing grease fires and sweat-soaked uniforms. It was perhaps the worst place to work in the entire city. The eponymous Ron slammed the door open and he stormed out of the building. "Say, what the hell do you think you're doing? The lunchtime rush is going to be coming soon." Sam seriously doubted that there would even be any customers, let alone a rush, but he still got out of his car promptly. It was best not to test the man. Short and stocky, Ron possessed a fiery temper that all too frequently was directed towards his employees. He traipsed up the stairs and into the building, feeling the hot glare of Ron on his back. Sarah was already in the shop, and she tended to a hot plate that was loaded with the day's selection of coffee cake and other sweet treats. The sign above it, professed that they were entirely homemade, but Sam knew, as well as every other employee, that they were really from the supermarket up the road. How on earth he had ended up here, Sam couldn't fathom. His life had turned into a complete shambles after the incident. Before he could start thinking about that dark day again, the ground shook. Ron screamed, a high-pitched noise that was very at odds with his normal demeanor. "What in the name of God was that?" the man exclaimed, as he ducked under a table. "Ah, yes, save yourself before you even think of us, of course," Sam thought bitterly as he helped Sarah under one of the larger tables. They crouched there in silence for a few minutes before the world was rocked by an even stronger quake. Sarah let out a whimper as she shook in tandem with the quake. Sam couldn't care less, to be honest. If he was going to go out, then this was as good a way as any. He laid a comforting hand on Sarah's shoulder, but he was already out of it. An incandescent light shone through the windows of the dingy establishment, and a third and far stronger earthquake started. Sam, along with the entire building, rocketed up into the air, and as he started to lose consciousness, he saw something impossible. A massive gray head filled the entire horizon as far as Sam could see. Even though it completely blocked out the sun, it seemed to exude a bright light, perhaps the source of the earlier flare. Sam stared into it fearlessly as he waited for death to claim him. He came to slowly, his hands wavering in and out of his vision as he waved them limply. He was standing on something smooth and solid, and as he saw what it was, he nearly had a heart attack. He was suspended in the middle of a vast and never-ending darkness, which was studded with balls that shone with every color of the rainbow and some more besides. He could feel the watching eyes of something coming from behind him, and he turned, afraid of what he was going to see. A man stood there, but not a normal man. His skin was completely gray, and his eyes were a smoky black color that caught Sam in its endless depth. He shook his head to force himself to break eye contact. The figure just stood there vacantly, as if it was a robot bereft of any sort of programming. He examined it for a few minutes, and realized with a start that it was the owner of the gray head that he had seen right before he was transported to wherever this was. If he was dead, this sure didn't look or feel like the afterlife. Maybe it was something wrong with his car exhaust pipe, and he had inhaled too much gas. Yes, that was probably it. He was high on carbon monoxide or some other engine product. Soon, he would wake up. Maybe in a hospital room somewhere, and everything would be all right. He could almost imagine this as he closed his eyes. He opened them once more, only to see the black eyes of the figure staring back. "Ah! God damn it!" he said as he backpedaled. Curious. "You are the only one I have seen so far that could resist my presence. Your innate mental fortitude must be quite high, even to withstand the pressure of this lowly form." The man paced around Sam and stared at him. If Sam was not a realist, then he would have said that the man was looking into his very soul. "Hey, who cares? Let's get on with the announcement." The figure stopped for a moment as if glitching, and then started to speak. It was the same voice, but it seemed to lack any sort of life, as if it was a pre-recorded message. "I'm sure that you're all wondering where you are right now. The multiversal records that I bought said that you denizens of this universe are highly intelligent. Good, the last one was no fun. Flying rocks only have so much space for brain matter." The man coughed once, and then continued. "That is not why I am here. I am Tantalos Viruvax, the new ruler of this universe. I want to tell you all something before the fun stuff starts." He leaned in and smiled a wide shark-toothed grin at Sam. "You are mine." He said this without a hint of emotion in his tone, somehow making the simple declaration much more sinister. You have 100 years to prepare, and then the first of my true minions are coming. That might seem like a lot to you mortals, but the truth is, that is nothing. Even if you had 10,000 years, it would not make an iota of difference. I am an ascendant, and you are mere mortals. Enjoy your time when it lasts. The system will explain the rest. Besides, I am but one of the things that you must worry about. And as for my unexpected conversation partner, I expect a lot of entertainment from you. The last sentence was spoken with the normal voice of the man, and Sam knew that it was directed solely at him. Tantalos disappeared, and Sam was falling down what seemed to be an infinite distance. Chapter 2. He landed with a hard bump on the top of a pickup truck, setting off a blaring alarm. He rolled off it and landed on his feet, wincing as his left leg gave slightly. His mind was racing with what he had just heard. Just the first few sentences were enough to set Sam off down a rabbit hole of conjectures. The words multiversal records meant nothing to him. Well, he knew what the words meant, of course, but there was no real world connotation to them. Suddenly, he felt a chill come over him. There was something wrong with the world. A moment later, he discovered what it was. The wind had suddenly stopped. Not only that, but all sound save for the beating of his heart and his shallow breaths was gone. A voice spoke directly into his mind a second later, causing him to jump. Humans, Lycanthi, Aberyths, Dugons, and the countless other sapient species of this universe, welcome to the Boundless Expanse. You have been granted this great opportunity courtesy of your sponsor, Tantalos Veruvax Theoal. All of existence is a far larger thing than any of your collective races have ever scratched the surface of. Your universe floats in the middle of the greater multiverse, which is in turn one of countless other multiverses that continue to stack upon each other upwards into infinity. Rejoice, for you are no longer mere peons of mortal drudgery, but citizens of a realm of endless potential. You all will shortly feel the effects of your initialization into this new order. The voice paused and waited for something. Sam waited as well, and then he suddenly doubled over in pain. A burning sensation, like lava was being poured directly into his chest area, overcame him. He rolled on the ground, trying to get some relief, but there was none. He lost track of where he was for a brief moment, and then all was still. Now that unpleasantness is gone, I can better explain what is happening. What you just received was a cultivation core. All of your wasted potential has been condensed into something that will allow you to transcend the shackles of your prior existences. You can now use my functions to manage and direct your growth. Level up, grow stronger, and make this universe tremble before you, or die as fodder for the one who will. Over the next year, various tournaments and other such growth-conducive events will allow you to establish a hierarchy among yourselves. True power is only achievable through true desire for growth. Good luck and farewell. Sam just stood there, stunned. This was all too much. Barely 10 minutes earlier, he had been walking into his dead-end job. What had changed since then? Apparently a lot. He sucked in a deep breath to steady himself, and then as he breathed out, something was kindled inside himself. Pausing, he repeated the action. It was as if there was an ember deep within his body that was being fanned by the winds of his breath. He closed his eyes. Something told him that this was the right thing to do, and he kept breathing. A light started to grow within his vision, and after a few more breaths, it stopped guttering. He looked at it in bemusement. It was a tiny orb-shaped object that glowed with a faint white light. Still, it gave off an imponderable, ineffable aura of infinite potential, as if it was the seed of some mighty tree, ready to grow into its full glory with the help of his careful tending. He opened his eyes, and the afterimage of the light was still there. His closed fist glowed with a faint blue light, and he opened it. A transparent blue screen expanded out of nowhere, appearing directly in front of his face. Sim Atlas Human Mortal Tier, G, Rank Class, Nun Level 1 Strength, 11, Onyx Constitution, 10, Onyx Resilience, 10, Onyx Dexterity, 7, Onyx Intelligence, 9, Onyx Intelligence, Wisdom, 11, Onyx Health, 100, 100, Mana, 90, 90. Stamina, 110, 110. Skills, 0 titles, 0 marks. Once Sam felt a strange attraction to the floating asterisk, and he selected it with his mind. Before he could take in just how bizarre this whole thing was, the floating display was replaced with another. Marks, 1 mark of Tantalus Viruvax grants greater ease of Tao formation. You have gained the barest fragment of a fraction of the interest of the being known as Tantalus Viruvax. As the sole inhabitant of this universe to resist his aura pressure, you have been marked as his personal project. Perform well, and your death will be swift. Perform poorly, and you will suffer the same fate as the rest of your universe. This mark can be hidden. This was probably a bad thing. One thing that Sam knew was that the odd ones out were always the first to die in any of the horror films that he had watched. Luckily, this seemed to have been countered by the ability to hide it. Hide it from what? Sam wondered. It wasn't as if anyone could see it, if he didn't have the strange floating screen open. He didn't even know if anyone else could see his personal screen. This screen reminded him of a status screen from a video game. He had played a few RPGs before, and this was very similar. He even had levels and stats. Were those gamified versions of his parameters in real life? The stat names were very simple, and he could have told what they meant even if he had never played a video game in his life. His strength was on the higher end of his stats, with the average around 10. He snorted as he read the number next to his dexterity. Yeah, you can say that again. Sam had been plagued by clumsiness for most of his life, and this seemed to confirm it. As to his other stats, they were all around the same range. Perhaps 10 was the average for a human? Sam knew that he was pretty average as things went, except apparently with his mental fortitude, as Tantalus had said. That was supposed to be quite high, although it wasn't marked on the stat screen. Maybe the man had meant willpower, but had said it in a fancy way. If so, that was a complete joke. If Sam had possessed some sort of incredible strength of will, he wouldn't have been in the situation that he had been before Tantalus came. A low growling noise came from his left. It was probably just a dog. Sam continued reading, sure in his assessment of the noise. A moment later, he was on the ground, with a creature hanging off his arm. He called it a creature because it was like nothing he had ever seen before. The closest thing that he could think of was a garden gnome. And that was a very loose parallel. The thing looked like a small greenish humanoid with a vast pot belly and viciously sharp teeth. It projected a vile odor into its immediate vicinity, and Sam started coughing. It seemed harmless enough, but then it started to glow. Sam grabbed it after that and threw it into a wall. There was no way that he was going to let some radioactive green alien latch onto his arm. He didn't want to get cancer. It picked itself up with a high-pitched screech and charged at him. It was far faster than it looked. It raised one of its forelegs. Sam wasn't sure whether it was running on all fours or simply running with extremely bad posture, and it slashed at his leg. Sam gasped. The tiny claws of the creature had sliced straight to the bone. He toppled over with a muffled squeak and turned to face the green beast as he fell. Luckily, he landed on top of it. The thing splattered underneath him, dousing the area and his clothes in a viscous green goo. You've killed a juvenile gremlin. You have leveled up. Chapter 3. Sam's leg started to knit back together, and he stared at it in amazement. This was impossible. He really needed to stop thinking that. The world had changed, whether for the better or the worse, he didn't know. His mind had started to calm, and he began to think more carefully about everything. First things first. He had leveled up, and if this worked like he thought it did, he would have acquired stat points to distribute. Opening his status again, he perused it more carefully. Underneath the stats, there was a list of three things: his health, his mana, and his stamina. Currently, his health and stamina were a few points below full. So leveling up replenished my resources. Not fully, though, so there's a limit to how much it heals me. Sam still had a few scratch marks where the deep cuts had been, and he scratched at them unconsciously. The basic function of the system seemed to be simpler enough, but it would probably get more complicated later on. His main question was what the Dao was. It had been spelled with a capital D, which meant that was important in some way. If he was not mistaken, his special mark was actually a boon as well as a sign of his uniqueness. More importantly, for now at least, he needed to get to safety. If there was one of those gremlins, then there were probably more. His defeat of the creature was more luck than anything else, and he didn't fancy his chances against multiple of them at the same time. He started running back towards the diner, hoping to get to his car. As he ran, he pulled out his phone and tried to turn it on. Nothing happened. The screen remained completely black, and he shook it with urgency. It stubbornly refused to turn on. Grumbling, he slid it back into his pocket and kept running. The parking lot of the diner came into view, and he ran for his car. He withdrew his key from his wallet and turned it desperately in the lock. The door opened, and he turned on the car. With a flash of amazement, he realized that his crappy car was probably going to save him. Unlike his phone, his car was an old school model, and it didn't have a digital display. All of those fancy electric cars would have been bricked by the advent of whatever effect had shorted out the electronics. He drove down the road and saw more of the gremlins. They chased after the car for a bit, but they couldn't keep up. Sam had an idea as he was driving down the road. Wait a minute, I can just run over these things with my car. How many levels would that give me? Sam turned around his vehicle and gunned the engine. The car sped down the road. Well, it was more accurate to say that it puttered, but Sam ignored the sad truth of his choice of transport and pretended that it was going at hundreds of miles an hour. For the first time in forever, he felt alive. The gremlins chittered as he neared them, and as he passed by, he could see that one of them was picking their teeth with something that looked disturbingly like the bone of a small child. He had convinced himself that it was just an animal bone by the time that he spotted a large group of gremlins. They were clustered around something, and the sound of chomping teeth carried over the air and to Sam's ears. He approached them and whooped as he prepared to run the creatures over, but he skidded as he saw what they were clustered around. A human corpse lay on the ground, barely recognizable as a person. It had been savaged by the gremlins, and the closest ones were stained red with viscera. Sam cursed as he realized that he had missed his chance. The gremlins had loosened their formation and were coming after him now. He spared one last look at the body and had to prevent a tear from running down his cheek. He was surprised by the sudden upwelling of emotion for a random stranger, but the way that the person had died was horrific. While he had been distracted by his shiny new system display, people had been dying. It was only dumb luck that had caused him to be spared while this other person had been devoured. Sam needed to get stronger so that this didn't happen to him. He drove down the street like a maniac, not knowing where to go. His small apartment was probably overrun by the gremlins by now, and he wanted to find somewhere safe to allocate his stat points. For the next 5 minutes, he drove straight out of town, eventually coming to a stop at a derelict gas station. The pool of blood that poured out from under the door told him everything he needed to know. Opening his status, he inspected the top part of it. Sam Atlas, human mortal tier G, rank class. None level 2, 2 free stat points, strength 11, on X constitution 10. On X resilience 10, on X dexterity 7, on X dexterity. Intelligence 9, on X wisdom 11, on X health 100 mana. He felt like a toddler in a candy store, perplexed by the multitude of shiny, delectable treats in front of him. He immediately ruled out intelligence and wisdom. Both the stats seemed to be useful. Intelligence increased his mana resource and wisdom, presumably made him wiser. Unfortunately, he had nothing to use his mana for, and it would be useless. Additionally, with only 2 points, dexterity was useless to invest in. Doing so wouldn't even raise him above the human average. Instead, he decided to go for strength. With a surge of energy, a wave of force shot out of his core, spreading through his body and then rebounding back into the core. They strained against the constraints of his skin, and he felt as if his muscles were going to burst through. After a minute, the feeling receded and he slumped backwards. He raised his right arm and flexed it. His bicep was noticeably larger than it had been before. He had been no slouch in the physical fitness department before, but this was something else. He felt a strange energy within him, as if his new power wanted him to do something with it. Sam clambered out of the car and dropped down to the ground. He started a series of lightning-fast push-ups, continuing after the point that he normally would have to stop. He beat it by almost double, which meant that stats didn't scale linearly over 10 points. It wasn't overpowered by any means. He knew that he wasn't even on the level of a professional athlete or anything. But he would be soon if he kept leveling up. He closed his status and reveled in the feeling of potency that he could still detect the last traces of. It was an intoxicating feeling, and he knew that it would only get better. Chapter 4. A faint series of howls could be heard in the distance, and he remembered that he was still very much vulnerable to those gremlins. He had barely defeated one of them before, and they seemed to swarm in packs rather than roam individually. He got back into his car and turned on the engine, but realized that there was only about a quarter of a tank left. Damn, I should have refilled it this morning. Who knew that the goddamn apocalypse would happen later in the day? Sam thought as he stared at the gauge. Then he clapped his face into his palm. He was literally parked in a gas station. He put the vehicle in reverse and sidled up to one of the pumps. Getting out of the car, he closed the door and took out the pour, inserting it onto the car. As he flicked the switch, he noticed a flash of green next to the main body of the pump. A flare of light illuminated the face of a gremlin smiling mischievously as it dropped a lit match onto the oil-slick floor. Shit! Sam screamed as he ran for cover. The explosion ripped through the gas station, detonating the supplies of gas below the ground. Pillars of flame erupted from the asphalt, and he was sent howling off into the distance. Sam woke up in an awkward position. His left leg was bent at an uncomfortable angle, and when he tried to move it, a bolt of pain shot up the limb. It was broken. Sam looked around him and saw that he was lying on the roof of the gas station, 1 foot protruding down into the roof of the building. Groaning as he withdrew his injured limb, he got himself fully up onto the roof. Sam cursed softly as he cradled his leg. The only way that he was going to get some healing was to level up again. Hopefully, a level up would be potent enough to heal him fully. Other than his broken leg, he was surprisingly unharmed. Perhaps strength improved his general durability a little, as it increased muscle density. The main problem was getting down off of the roof with his broken limb. The only way that he was going to get down was by either falling or climbing, both a no-go with his broken leg. Besides, the ground was covered in a crawling carpet of gremlins, all attracted by the fire. Mere seconds later, a shockwave ripped through the air as something exploded in the middle of the crowd of gremlins. A man strode out from behind a nearby building, cocking a shotgun that had the unlikely addition of a grenade launcher to it. Sam stared. He recognized that man. It was Jeffrey, the survivalist that everyone in the town thought was crazy. The man lived on the edge of town in a shack and would frequently set off explosions. The only reason that nobody ever complained was out of fear for their safety. Now his preparations had been justified. Jeffrey pointed the shotgun at the gremlins, and rather than bullets, miniature fireworks spiraled out. They were clearly modified, as none of them exploded in the normal colorful displays of a firework, but with the orange glow of gunpowder. The gremlins fled the area, and Jeffrey approached the gas station. "What you doing up there?" the man called out in his rough, raspy voice. "What the hell does it look like? Admiring the scenery or something?" "My damn leg's broken." Jeffrey nodded sagely at this. "Ah, take this then. It'll fix you up real good." The man tossed up a small crystal that was a deep red in color. As Sam caught it, his interface popped up. "Contact with mana enhanced object achieved. You have gained the skill basic analyze, common. Use a small amount of mana to gain a basic sense of what a thing is." A mote of light appeared on the gem, and Sam stared at it. With a pop, he felt a little of his mana drain out of him and into his eyes. They lit up, and he stared at the crystal. Basic healing crystal, Einmal. G-rank magical item. A condensed nugget of life, expected energy. This crystal only can heal those of the lowest levels to any great extent. Excessive consumption will pollute your core and mana channel. Sam debated whether or not to use the crystal with himself. Core pollution didn't sound very appealing, but it said that happened only in cases of excessive consumption. One use would probably be fine. Unsure of how to use it, Sam clenched his fist around it to bring it up to his face, but the stone crumbled away and a red light sank into his body. He could feel a warm sensation creeping down his leg and into the limb. A crack like a gunshot rang out as his bones snapped back together. Sam clenched his teeth to avoid crying out. Why would people use these things willingly? He tested his leg and was surprised to find that it was completely healed. Oh, that's why. Such an effect was nothing short of miraculous. Something that would have taken weeks or even months to heal normally had been mended in a matter of seconds. He looked down over the side of the station. Jeffrey stared at him with a gap-toothed smile. Come on down, boy. I don't bite. Sam sighed and jumped off the side of the gas station, landing with a thump on the concrete. He walked over to Jeffrey and looked him over. So did the other man, apparently, as he began to speak. Only level 2? Come on now, I'm already level 7. What have you been doing since the green critters appeared? Sam was shocked. If the other man was really telling the truth, then he was far beyond human now. Sam used his new skill on Jeffrey. Jeffrey Hollings, level 7, human, unlike in games. There was no health bar under the man's name. Well, this was a simple analysis skill after all. All it was supposed to do was to tell you about something, not file an IRS report about the subject. Maybe if he upgraded it further, it would reveal more. So far, the rarities were similar to in video games, another point of similarity. This was almost surreal. He felt an irresistible force pulling at his right arm. Hurry the hell up! We need to get to safety, Jeffrey said irritably. The man was basically dragging Sam down the road. What about the car? You want to drive that thing? Jeffrey scoffed as he pointed at the melted heap of scrap that was all that remained of Sam's car. Oh! It hadn't been the best of cars, but it had still been his car. He felt a small twinge of sadness at leaving it behind, but it was only a car. He had far more pressing concerns. When he looked at Jeffrey again, he saw something that made him want to close his eyes. The man's legs were moving as if they were walking, but they had faint afterimages as they went back and forth. He must have pumped his dexterity or something to make him go that fast. His strength, too. His fingers were like iron bars clenched tight around Sam's wrist. A small group of gremlins came around the corner, but Jeffrey growled at them and they went away. Sam let the man pull him limply. He was extremely tired, probably an effect of the healing. They moved around the town at a quick pace, and eventually they left it and went into the woods. A faint light beckoned from between the trees and Jeffrey sighed. Ah, my humble abode. Ain't no gremlin bastards around here. Well, there are some, but I made sure to put the fear of God in them. He dragged Sam into the building and slammed the door behind him. Sam took in the door. It was a foot-thick construction of solid metal and concrete. The thing must have weighed over a ton. Jeffrey must have had some money hidden away somewhere, as there was no way that he could have afforded something like that without significant cash. Jeffrey sat down with a satisfied groan and slammed back a shot of amber whiskey that was waiting for him on the side of his table. Damn, that hits the spot. Ain't no government bastards coming around here to try to condemn this place, no sir. Jeffrey cackled, madly. Besides, if they did, I would give them a good taste of my fist. Sam sighed. He was now stuck with a man who was very possibly out of his head. You do realize that all the government people are probably leveling up faster than us? Though, to be fair, they all might be dead. And that last thing you said, well, I would just think about it before saying it in polite company. Jeffrey snorted. Polite company? All those people are probably dead now. Taken by them gremlins. Jeffrey was probably right, but Sam didn't indulge him. Now that they were safe, he had a few questions for the man. Okay. So, you're a higher level than me, right? Yeah. What of it? Have you ever heard of the Dao? Sam asked. The Dao? What's that? Some sort of Chinese food? Sam sighed. Never mind. Can I get out of here? I need to level. Be my guest. If you die, it ain't my fault, though. Also, that leveling thing slows down a lot very quickly. What's that called? Deviating returns or something? No, I think you mean diminishing returns, Sam said. Also, I think you might want to put a few points into intelligence. That last bit was said as he was already halfway out of the door, so by the time Jeffrey understood him, he was already gone. Chapter 5. The outside of the shack was thankfully clear of gremlins, and Sam decided to search for a weapon. There was a shed out back, and he assumed that it would be a likely place for there to be a weapon. Sam slunk around the building. He didn't know if Jeffrey would approve of his thievery, and made his way to the wooden building. It was dark inside, and he could faintly make out the shadows of rows upon rows of tools hanging inside. When he turned the light on, surprised that the power was still on, he saw that they were all of a make and design that, yet again, Jeffrey shouldn't have been able to afford. He sensed that there was some kind of backstory to the man, and why he was so obsessed with doomsday planning, and that below the unsophisticated veneer, there was something more going on there. He picked out a large machete. The oversized knife could just as easily slice through monsters as cut through branches. Leaving the shed, he heard a faint noise, like an animal in pain, sighing. As he knew that this was probably a trap, he still went towards it. justifying his stupidity by the fact that there were probably a lot of potential levels on the line if he followed the noise, he ran through the woods. A clearing opened up dead ahead and he ran towards it. The noise was getting louder and more urgent as he neared. Finally, he saw the source of the commotion. A strange monster, some kind of reptilian centipede, was surrounded by a swarm of gremlins. The creature was mewling piteously as the gremlins tore at it with their claws and sharp teeth. Sam started backing up. This was a battle that he did not want, but his foot caught a wayward branch and the soft crack caused every gremlin in the clearing to look up. The vicious green creatures snarled in unison and charged him. Knowing that he couldn't outrun them, Sam was cursing himself for not placing points into dexterity. So he chose to stand and fight. With his machete clutched tightly, he lashed out at the monsters as they neared. Gremlin after gremlin was turned into green goo by his machete, and his higher strength made it so that he was killing multiple of them at the same time. Still, many of them made it through, and his body was soon littered with scars from their attacks. He made sure to explicitly target any of the gremlins that started to glow, and this prevented him from taking too much damage. Still, by the time the last of the approximately 30 gremlins was down, his health was below half full. With a surge of energy, his wounds started to heal over. Sam groaned. So, I can't level up in combat. Great. You have killed a juvenile gremlin. Erdi-1, you have leveled up. X4. Damn, but the diminishing returns were starting to kick in. How many gremlins had Jeffrey killed to reach level 7? It was probably over 100. Sam opened his status and thought about how to allocate the points. Strength seemed to be the way to go with most of his points, but as the battle had just shown, dexterity was useful for escaping situations in which high strength might be useless. Additionally, he wanted to see what constitution and resilience did. He decided to trickle feed the points in order to avoid the effects of using many of them at one time. If only 2 had almost debilitated him, then 8 would probably have him on the ground. The first one went into strength. Now that the stat was a bit higher, the stretching sensation was not as intense, although that could be because of the lesser quantity of stat points. Another point went into strength as the feeling subsided, and a final one was placed into the stat after. Preparing for a strange new feeling to kick in, Sam added a point to dexterity. This feeling was far more pleasant than that of strength. It was as if he had just drunk the most caffeinated drink in existence, and he had all the alertness, but without the jitters. His limbs felt more responsive, and as he moved them, he could feel the tips of his fingers with a startling clarity. Sam chuckled and placed another point into the stat. As much as he wanted to just stand there and continue to feel the buzz, he had other stats to enhance. He had 3 points left, and he wanted to put 2 into constitution and 1 into resilience. His mental stats could wait for now. The first point was placed into constitution. His entire body started to roil with an internal heat, and that heat started to ramp up quickly. It felt as if he was being slowly cooked inside a pressure cooker, and as the pain reached a crescendo, he could feel his organs and skin knitting together and becoming denser and more durable. He had to psyche himself up to place another point into the stat, and he braced against a tree for the feeling to overtake him. It was a little better this time, but not by much. Finally, resilience was the last stat to increase. He placed in the point, not knowing what would happen. Immediately, something felt wrong. A series of cracking noises erupted from his body, and a searing pain tore through him as his bones broke and reformed. Energy was being drawn from somewhere, and it was increasing his mass. Not by much, but by a decent amount still. He rolled around as the pain crashed through him in waves, but he eventually was able to overcome it. Beads of sweat trickled down his chin, and he had to rest for a minute before getting up. Tentatively, he squared up in a boxing stance and punched a tree. To his surprise, his fist didn't rebound with a flare of pain. Instead, the wood crunched under it, creating a small dent. He stared at his fist in wonder. This was even better than he had expected. Apparently, the physical stats were meant to work together. He made his way over to the strange centipede-like creature and examined it juvenile herpetopedae, level 6. Sam remembered from biology that herpetology was the study of snakes. The name seemed to confirm his assessment of the creature's nature. It made a weak, purring noise and tried to move closer to him. He tentatively reached out, expecting this to be a trick and for the creature to bite him. Instead, it licked his hand weakly with a long forked tongue. The thing was growing on him quickly, and he decided that he wanted to save it. He picked it up with a grunt, surprised at how heavy the barely 4-foot-long creature was. Sam walked through the woods back to the house, surprised at how fast he could move. Now that he was closer to the human average, he realized how normal people must have felt. He was a long way from being the Flash or something like that, but he was edging his way up. As he reached the shack, he remembered the machete. It was covered in patches of green ichor, and he was sure that Jeffrey wouldn't appreciate that. He wiped it off on a patch of grass and hung it back up in the shed. He walked up to the front door and knocked on it. A slot opened up in the middle, and he was met with the barrel of a shotgun. "Jesus, Jeffrey. It's just me." "Oh, can't be too careful," Jeffrey said before opening the door. Noticeably, he still hefted the shotgun. "What the hell is that?" Jeffrey screamed as he saw the herpetop. He tried to grab at it, but Sam snatched it away. Hey. "I found this little guy outside. He seemed to be peaceful. I wanted to see if we could train him." Jeffrey snorted. "All right, but don't let that mutant freak anywhere near me, understand?" Sam nodded as he carried the monster off into a back room. He searched for a medical kit and found one after a few minutes of searching. Of course, there were about 25 other medical kits with it. What kind of paranoid man gets this many supplies? There's something going on here. The idea that Jeffrey had somehow known about the coming of the system was very unlikely, but still plausible. For now, it didn't matter. The man was helping him, and this was enough. He placed down the monster on a table and opened the medical kit. He pulled out a pair of rubber gloves and some disinfectant. He didn't want to get some sort of alien virus off this thing. Sam put on the gloves and flipped the creature over. There was a gaping wound on the other side of the body, and a thick yellow fluid leaked out of it. A foul stench wafted out of it, and Sam wrinkled his nose. "Let's get you fixed up, little guy." He dabbed at the wound with some cotton balls and removed the liquid from it. Next, he doused the wound with disinfectant, winching as the creature started to toss and turn. Finally, he covered the wound with a large bandage and wrapped the creature up in gauze. It lay there, breathing shallowly, and Sam left it. There was nothing more he could do, and he wasn't going to ask Jeffrey for a healing crystal to use on a monster. Sam went back into the front room to find Jeffrey tinkering with what looked to be a machine gun. Chapter 6. Is that a machine gun? Sure is. Picked up this beauty at a military surplus store. Well, it was more of an illegal arms auction, but semantics. This'll be good for using on those green things. The man stroked the barrel of the machine gun. This must have been a dream come true for him. Even in America, people weren't allowed to just fire off military-grade weapons. Now could do so to his heart's content. The government had probably fallen by now, and if it hadn't, then they were too busy now to worry about things like an illegal machine gun. Especially when it would help to defend the country. Okay, by the way, Did you see any other survivors anywhere in the town?
I saw a lot of dead bodies, but nobody was alive except for you.
The other man shook his head before spitting on the ground.
Damn gremlins must have killed them all off.
I didn't see a soul, except for you.
Jeffrey continued to clean out his machine gun, and Sam sighed. It was just the two of them against the monsters.
He looked outside. It was already getting dark.
Something strange had happened with the sun, and it looked to be a lot smaller than usual.
That was a question for the morning, however, and he found a vacant cot in the corner of the room. In a distant quadrant of the multiverse, Tantalus Veruvax chuckled as he watched the antics of his newly purchased universe's inhabitants. The first day was always most enjoyable to watch. Seeing mortals dying to the scum of the multiverse was enough to make his day. The gremlins were so weak on a normal scale that they weren't even cold when they overpopulated an area. Against these people, they were more than enough to kill them off. Most of the civilizations in the universe had already been wiped out. The vast majority of them had been backward societies, the equivalent of the Stone Age back on Earth. Only a few had advanced technology, and those were the ones that had survived. Curiously, with the absence of higher technology, one species was performing better than the others. The humans were at a point in their development where they were starting to phase out their current technology for more advanced digital tech, but they still had older devices that didn't rely on computing. Tantalos smiled as he remembered the fall of the Chironax, a race of cyborgs that had transcended normal mortal parameters. Their suits had stopped working as soon as the system arrived, and in desperation, they had tried to launch an antimatter bomb. Unfortunately, the bomb worked, but the controls didn't, and their entire solar system had been wiped clear off the map. The amount of destruction that unenhanced technology could achieve was quite impressive, even to Tantalos, but there was no real point comparing it to the rest of the multiverse. Some civilizations had fused the system with their tech, but they still relied mostly on leveling and stats to even the board. It was going to be a nasty surprise for the humans when they found out that their weapons would only be effective against the very weakest of monsters. Tantalos sighed as he sat back on his chair, playing through the day's highlights in his brain. His intelligence was so high that he could easily see everything that was happening inside a universe at once. And he was only a B-ranked ascendant. The actual gods could monitor everything inside the entire multiverse at once. He was afraid of only one thing, those impossibly powerful beings. Once, millions of years ago, he had committed the equivalent of a bank robbery on a vault universe. Unfortunately for him, he had stolen the wrong item, a keepsake that belonged to one of the 99 creator kings. One of them had come for him, and he remembered vividly what had happened to him. For billions of years in subjective time, the god had kept him inside a mental hellscape where he suffered through an uncountable number of incredibly painful deaths. It was only thanks to his enhanced mind that he was able to avoid going insane during that. He shuddered as he remembered that, and he cleared his mind. It was time for some diversions. He couldn't control the monsters spawning inside the universe, as it was only a result of the integration of the universe into the system, but he could throw a few curveballs into the mix. Firstly, the herpetopede that his project had found. With a surge of power, Tantalos enforced his will across the multiversal divide, using his universal ownership orb to channel it into it. An infinitesimal spark of his own intellect drifted off through the void and into the universe. Earth, Jeffrey's hut Rax was hungry. That was the first coherent thought that the herpetopede had possessed in his entire life. He vaguely remembered the previous day, when a strange pinkish creature had saved him from a group of gremlins. He hissed as he remembered the gremlins. Back on his homeworld, a place where all of his kind lived in harmony with the sapient inhabitants, there were none of those foul beasts. He felt an urge to find his savior and to pledge his undying allegiance to it.
A moment later, he felt pain such as he had never felt before. His entire body was being remade, and he could feel his legs lengthening, becoming more efficient, his neurons developing, his brain becoming like that of a sapient. With a wailing cry, he lost consciousness. Sam was woken up by a high-pitched squealing noise, coming from where the herpetopede had been. He realized that the creature was in some sort of distress as he listened, and he bolted into the room. Jeffrey was already there, the man standing over it with a hammer.
Jeffrey!
What are you doing? The man looked over at Sam. What's it look like?
This thing got possessed or something. Look!
Sam rushed over to the creature. It was barely recognizable as the thing that he had rescued earlier. It had gained about 50% more length, and it was far stockier than it had been before. Its tongue darted in and out of its mouth, trying to draw in air. Jeffrey moved to strike it, but Sam put his arm in the way. A crushing force bore down on him as his arm met Jeffrey's, but the man quickly withdrew his hand.
If you want to cavort with the thing, then fine.
But if it comes for me, then it's dead. Jeffrey said in exasperation as he threw the hammer aside and went back to his room. Sam was about to tell the man not to say cavort in that context ever again, but he was already out of the room. Sam sat down by the creature.
What am I going to do with you?
He said as he looked at it. The thing let out a noise and its eyes opened.
Where am I?
Sam jumped back. The herpetopede had just spoken to him. Its voice was a sibilant hiss, but it was still very clear what it was saying.
Can you understand me?
The creature nodded at this.
Were you the pink flesh that saved me?
Pink flesh?
Does it mean human?
Yes.
I was.
My name is Sam.
Do you have a name?
I am Rax.
Just Rax?
No surname? Rax tilted its head.
What is this surname thing?
I am a fertilizer of my species. What need would I have for a surname?
I didn't even have a normal name before something filled me with knowledge and intelligence, Rax said in his hissing voice.
Fertilizer?
So you what? Help make more herpetopedes?
I would find females and wait for them to lay their eggs before I fertilized them.
Oh,
I've heard about that before.
We have some creatures here that do that.
Rax nodded absently as he looked around the room.
You save me, so I want to follow you.
Will you let me be your companion?
Sure, but how do I do that?
Sam asked.
You need to add me to your party.
Sam stared at the herpetoad.
What? Like a birthday party? Or something like in a game.
How do I do that?
You need to focus on me and imagine forming a bond between yourself and I.
It should give me a prompt to join your party. Feeling a little stupid, Sam stared at Rax for a long time. With a chime, he received a new notification.
Rax has joined your party.
Sam opened up his status to see if there was anything there about a party. Sam Atlas, human mortal tier, G rank class, none level 6 strength, 16, on X constitution, 12 on X resilience, 11, on X dexterity, 9, on X intelligence, 9, on X intelligence, 9, on X 8, wisdom, 11, on X health, 120, 120, mana, 90, 90 stamina, 160, 160 skills, 1 titles, 0 marks, 1 party, 1 Sam. Selected the party button, auto.
Party, 1 Rax, level 6.
Health, 140. 140. It was like the interface in one of those old-school RPGs, which Sam had expected, judging by the current bent of the system. A moment later, something strange happened. Chapter 7,
Hello? Can you hear me? Sam almost jumped out of his skin. What? Who's there?
It's me.
Rax.1. We can talk mentally now that I am in your party. For some reason, it's as if I already was a part of the system. I know how to work it.
I don't know why, though.
Sam closed his eyes and tried to connect with the reptile through the party link. It felt very strange, but he was able to extend a tendril of his awareness out through the system and into Rax's mind.
Hello.
Are you there? Rax nodded. Yes. I'm here, and I can hear you clearly. Sam was satisfied with this. It would be useful in a fight, as there would be too much noise and distractions to talk normally. But talking mentally required no medium at all. Rax got off of the table, landing with a thud. Not only had the creature gotten bigger, he had gotten a lot heavier as well. They walked into the front room to find Jeffrey still working on his machine gun.
Hey.
Check this out. Sam said, if it's that damn lizard again. I'm not a lizard. I'm a herpetope.
What the hell?
Jeffrey jumped off of the seat and snatched up his shotgun from the floor. Cocking it, he pointed it at Rax. Before Sam could do anything, Jeffrey pulled the trigger. The shotgun fired with a deafening bang, and Rax was blown backwards.
No!
Why did you do that? Sam screamed as he rushed to the side of the lizard. He blinked. There were only a few shallow cuts. The bullets lay on the floor, next to Rax, warped and bent. Checking his party list, he saw that his companion had only lost 20 health. This was the first inkling that Sam had about just how screwed humanity was. Never mind.
He's fine. Mon Miljian, Payan's Messier, Engineer Mil, poor soul, or.
But how? Rax got to his many feet with a grunt. That scruffy human is quite the specimen. Aggressive, unkempt, and mateless. Jeffrey and Sam stared at the lizard in astonishment. Sam started laughing uncontrollably.
What?
Was it something that I said?
Ha! Hey!
Jeffrey, you just got dissed by a lizard, not a lizard, Rax said. The others ignored him. Jeffrey snarled at Rax, but Sam could tell that he had found it amusing as well. What are our plans? We can't stay in this shack forever.
We need to level up,
Sam said, trying to steer the conversation back to something more useful. Well, I was going to use this machine gun to take out some of them gremlins, but now that I saw how tough Rax was, it's probably useless. It's going to be inefficient to kill the gremlins anyway, and we need to find some stronger creatures. Jeffrey answered. He threw the massive gun to the side in disgust, lifting it like it was a child's toy. Those weapons in the shed worked pretty well, Sam suggested.
Wait, where did you get that healing crystal from?
Do you have any more? Jeffrey shrugged.
Some big bastard dropped it.
It was shaped like a gremlin, but the thing was about my size. I gave it the good old double barrel treatment and then a few more times for good measure. It was very soft, but it seemed to empower the other gremlins around it. I remember that it had opened its mouth, like it was going to say something, but I shut it up real good. That's why I'm level 8. It pushed me up from level 7 to the next one. Sam was intrigued by the thought of the gremlin commander, or whatever the thing was.
Did you get a chance to analyze it?
Sam asked Jeffrey. No, but my post-battle log said that it was a mature gremlin. So the small ones are basically babies? Jeffrey nodded. Sam wasn't sure about how he felt on the subject of killing baby creatures, no matter how vicious they were. Then he remembered the corpses in the town, and his heart hardened. Well, they tried to kill us, so it's only fair that we kill them.
Damn right, Jeffrey said.
Sam and Rax left the shack, looking for some gremlins to kill. Jeffrey had stayed behind, professing that he needed to work on his gun. They walked for over 20 minutes before they found a trace of a gremlin. It was dead. There were no more in sight, and Sam felt a chill run down his spine as he surveyed the empty woods. Suddenly, he was bowled over by something. He was about to stab it with his machete, but he saw that it was Rax. The lizard had pushed him out of the way of a crossbow bolt that had struck a small sapling where it vibrated. He looked at the source of the projectile, a woman in tattered jeans and a t-shirt. She pouted as she looked at him.
Pity, I guess I have to do this the hard way.
The woman pulled out a katana from a sheath as she holstered her bow and advanced on Sam. There was no point in trying to negotiate with her. The woman was clearly a murderer, as evinced by the dried blood on her blade. A crazed look overtook her as she neared him. She then did something that Sam had only ever seen in bad anime shows. The woman raised the blade to her mouth and ran her tongue down it before laughing maniacally. Turns out, humans give far more levels than those monsters. You and your companion seem to be quite the juicy treat. A red glow flared around her blade, only giving Sam a split second's worth of warning. The weapon flashed forwards, far too quickly for him to see, and it was only a desperate jerk of his body that made the blade miss his neck. Instead, it bit deep into his left arm, sliding through without a hint of resistance. He tried to strike back with his machete, but the woman dodged it. Panicked, he analyzed the woman. Lena's scarlet level, 12 human she, was double his level, and she had the skills to match it. It was very unlikely that he was going to survive this. She sent out her blade again like a mosquito's proboscis searching for blood. Sam rolled away and the sword came down on the ground next to him. The blade stuck into the dirt, but she ripped it out with ease and reversed her grip. Sam was in a bad position and he was unable to dodge in time. He raised his hands desperately and something happened. A wave of blue energy rippled over his forearms and coated them with an almost transparent sheen of power. The sword crashed into them and he was sent flying backwards. Instead of having become a double amputee, all he had to show was a thin line of red running down his forearms. He knew that he couldn't use it again, though, as his mana was almost out. The woman let out a disgruntled snort, and she prepared to charge him, but Rax latched onto her ankle with his fangs. The snake centipede hybrid tore at her limb, and a spray of blood shot out, covering the surrounding grass with a thick patina of red. The woman cursed and she backhanded the lizard, knocking him backwards. He rose, unsteady, but she ignored him.
Huh, I guess I misjudged you. I haven't found someone with any skill other than the analysis one so far. That means that you will give me a lot more power than the others.
Just how many humans have you killed so far? Sam said, not really wanting to know the answer.
I lost track after the first 100.
Sam felt sick. More importantly, a roiling rage filled his body. Humanity had to stay together if they were to survive, not turn on each other like rabid dogs. If this woman survived, she would cause havoc upon the world. Not only that, but there were probably many more like her out there. His veins started to pulse in time with his heart, and he felt the world slip away. Chapter 8. Sam found himself floating in space for the second time in less than a day. In front of him, an incredible scene unfolded. Two figures faced off, standing on nothing. They were talking to each other, but Sam couldn't make out the words. Finally, one of them smiled in a wide rictus grin,
and laughed as a clone of himself appeared behind the other man. Sam drifted closer and closer to the fighters as the scene progressed, and he could make out their faces. The man with the clone was a snake-like humanoid with narrow eyes and a slit instead of a nose. He looked like the epitome of evil to Sam. The other man was completely average in every way, save for his overwhelming presence. Sam noticed that he was surrounded by a shimmering dome of white energy, and he could faintly feel something hammering on it. It was as if, simply by existing, the two men were creating a pressure in the space around them. If not for the barrier, Sam would have been blasted by the full force of that effect. With a raised hand, the pressure from the average-looking man surged and the clone shone with a bright light. It screamed in pain as white fire consumed it completely. The snake man's face contorted in fear, and he tried to back away. Something happened between that moment and the next, and suddenly the average-looking man had his fist through the snake man's chest. Strangely, there was no triumph on his face, only a cold sadness. The vision faded away, and Sam found himself back in the real world. He stared at the woman with a vacant expression on his face, and she faltered in her charge. A ripple of energy shot out from his body and into the world around him, outlining the woman in a deep black aura. Immediately, his limbs filled with strength, and he was the one charging her. She raised her sword to block, and Sam's machete came down on it. She resisted it, grinning as she did so, but his other hand snaked around the sword and grabbed her throat, eyes bulging. She tore at his arm as he lifted her off the ground. She carved his flesh down to the bone, but still, he did not let go. With a sickening crunch, her neck broke, and he let go. His body filled with fatigue, and he collapsed bonelessly to the ground. There were a few new things in his notifications, which he checked. Dao has been unlocked. Dao mode of the Arbiter, there are many different types of warriors in this world. There are the dishonorable, the stalwart of spirit, and the desperate. Rarely do any find a true purpose in their journeys, simply looking for strength or other such ephemera. You have found your calling, the calling of justice. In your searing hate for those who act with evil, you find your absolution. In their deaths, you find peace. You feel no joy in their ends, but merely a sense of purpose. Such is the path of the Arbiter. Before he could think about what that meant, the next notification popped up. You have gained a skill, Lesser Mana Bulwark, rare. Infuse mana into your flesh to improve defense. You have gained the Dao skill, Eyes of Judgment, legendary. Your path dictates your purpose. Your purpose is to purge the world of evil. Upon use of this skill, enemies are laid bare to your sight, revealing their sins. You gain additional power against the sinful, but reduced power against the truly virtuous. These power modifiers only apply after the skill has been used. Finally, something appeared that made his entire being vibrate in shock. Waves of searing energy washed over his body as the notification surfaced. You have gained the title, Dao, Paragon, of the 10,239,428.157th universe, Celestial. You are the very first being in your entire universe to form a Dao. 85% to all stats, rounding to the nearest whole number. Sam stared at the title in shock. It was far beyond anything he had expected. He had known that the mark would have given him a leg up in the creation of a Dao, but not to such a degree that he was the very first in the universe to get it. It seemed as if Tantalus was very interested in him indeed, contrary to what the mark said. He suspected that the man had written the description of that mark himself to downplay his involvement. Sam remembered reading the Greek myths in school
and one of the themes in it was that the gods were constantly interacting with mortals. Even someone who is immortal still experienced boredom, and from the way that Tantalos had spoken to him the other day, he was his new toy to play with. Immediately, he felt a resonation in his soul at the thought. Something stirred inside him, and it was angry. Nestled next to his core, there was a small package of something indescribable. It was like there was a concentrated mass of everything that the Tao of the Arbiter entailed. The package was connected to the rest of his body with infinitesimal tendrils of energy, which was how it was influencing his mental state. He knew in his heart that Tantalos Varuvax was the true threat to this universe, the serpent in the tree, the yin to his yang, the adversary. If this universe did not band together against the threat, then there would be no universe left afterwards. The idea that someone could destroy a universe was mind-boggling to Sam, but he knew that it was all too real. He had experienced the power of Tantalos for himself. The man had seized the entire population of the universe and spoken to them all at once. In addition, the monsters that appeared were most certainly not natural beings. They were coming from somewhere else, perhaps outside of the universe. As Sam stared ahead into the distance, thinking about the long and dangerous road ahead, a faint smile eased its way onto his face. This would be his calling, his path. He would become the strongest, so that he could protect those who could not protect themselves. He would be the shield that defended his universe, the horn that called the soldiers of the light to victory. These grandiose thoughts seemed to resonate with his Tao, and he felt the small object grow a little bit larger. This was not related to his stats at all, as the Tao was a purely spiritual object. It was related to what he envisioned his path to be. The best translation that Sam knew was that it was his way. Chapter 9. He snapped out of his contemplative state and looked around him. Suddenly ashamed at how he had not even bothered to look out for enemies as he pondered his Tao, he ran towards Rax. The herpetipede was mostly unharmed, but he had some bruises lining his body. The insane woman who had tried to kill him had only struck the lizard lightly, in order to get him away from her. Most of her focus had been on Sam. With a start, he remembered that she had pierced his arm through, but he didn't feel any bleeding. He must have leveled up during that fight. As if it had been suppressed before, his notifications came in. You have killed Lena Scarlet. You have leveled up. X3. Now that he had a baseline for how leveling worked, he saw that there was some sort of inefficiency in the system. Common sense dictated that if he killed someone who was of a higher level than him, he should level up to that level, if not beyond it, on account of gaining the extra power. Instead, most of the energy that he got for killing something was leached away into thin air and was lost to him. When he saw the party link, he saw that some of it had in fact been diverted away from him, to Rax, but the herpetipede had only gained a single level, which was not enough to add up to the amount that he should have gotten. Sighing, Sam accepted it. It was probably some sort of tax from the system, in order to pay for its workings. Just the ability to level up at all was more valuable than a few missed levels. Sam and Rax stumbled back through the woods and entered the shack. Jeffrey was snoring when they went in, and the man woke suddenly as they entered, clutching his shotgun. Do you never have that thing out of sight? Jeffrey snorted. This thing has been my best friend for the last few years. Between this and my intimidating reputation, nobody has bothered me in a while. Well, yeah, nobody was stupid enough to bother a madman with a gun. Really? That must have been pretty useful. Jeffrey nodded happily, not knowing what Sam was really thinking. Sam and Rax went to the back room, and Sam changed his clothes. They were filthy from the events of the previous day, and luckily Jeffrey had a closet full of clothes. Unfortunately for Sam, they were all what he would describe as redneck chic, but he put on the overalls and matching attire anyway. Beggars couldn't be choosers during the apocalypse. With his wardrobe change completed, Sam fell into his cot and slept. His entire body was sore, and he felt as if he had just run a marathon. A bright white light cajoled him out of his slumber. "Jeffrey? What are you doing with that light?" A few voices conversed out of proper earshot of Sam. "One handy, young or stay." Someone started shaking him vigorously. He opened his eyes in annoyance, and then saw that he was no longer in the shack. He lay on the floor of a vast atrium, filled with other people. A massive floating figure hung over the area, a humanoid being that was made up of starlight. The people who had woken him up smiled at him absently. "Sorry, you really didn't want to miss the system announcement," a woman said to him. Sam bolted upright and stood up. The people around him made room for him, and a man was about to say something, but then the lights went out. "Greetings, humans of planet Earth. I called you all here to congratulate you. Out of the billions of people on your planet, you are the only survivors." Shocked whispers drifted around the atrium at this announcement. "Not only that, but out of the various species of your universe, you have the largest surviving percentage. For that, you will all be rewarded. In the upcoming inter-universal tournament, you will all be given favorable seeds. Finally, it has come to my attention that one of you has formed a DAO. Not only that, but that it is the very first one in the universe. I implore that person to explore their talents to the fullest and most of all, trust nobody." Three expanded charts appeared in the air in front of them. A notification surfaced in front of Sam as well. "Choose your display name for the planetary leaderboards." Sam thought about what would be a good name for him. Obviously, he didn't want to reveal his full name, so he needed a pseudonym. What better name than that of his DAO? "You have picked the name." The Arbiter other names started to appear on the leaderboards, and after a few minutes, they were filled. A smaller version of them appeared before him, and he read them. Levels Leaderboard. The Overlord, level 18, Rodney Kane, level 17. The Scourge of New York, level 17, Phoenix. Level 17, Melissa Tang. Level 16, The Angel of Death. Level 15, Profound Visionary. Level 14, Elminster Judge. Level 13, Elminster Judge. Anonymous, level 12. The Bear of the Motherland, level 11. It was easy to tell stuff about these people from their names. The name of the third place person sounded like a title to Sam, maybe one for clearing New York of monsters, or something like that. The first place was pretty fitting, belonging to the Overlord. Some of the names were probably the real names of the people, whereas the others were made up. He studied the next leaderboard. DAO leaderboard, Onestedia. The Arbiter, he was the only one on it. A broad smile lifted his cheeks as he looked at it, drawing some stares from the other. He could hear a few muffled whispers coming from around him. "Who's this Arbiter guy? He's not on the levels leaderboard. What's a DAO?" Sam was very glad that he had chosen to conceal his name. The final leaderboard popped up in his vision. Overall, Power 1. The Overlord 2. Rodney Kane 3. The Scourge of New York 4. The Arbiter 5. Die. Phoenix 6. Melissa Tang 7. The Angel of Death 8. Profound Visionary 9. Elminster Judge Tentardal. Anonymous. After he finished reading them, two more notifications came up. "You have gained the temporary title, #1DAO, Planet Earth, Mythical. 5% to all stats, and plus 10% chance of a DAO breakthrough. You have gained the temporary title, Top 5 Power, Planet Earth, Legendary, .tie. 2.5% to all stats. Temporary titles are titles that are dependent on some impermanent requirement, such as the possession of an object. These titles were nowhere near as good as his celestial title, but they were still quite good. Sam pored through the leaderboards in depth and discovered that he could see the top 1,000 people if he scrolled down far enough. After a moment, the avatar of the system resumed its spiel. After 1 year, intergalactic teleportation will become available to purchase. After that, then the galactic, intergalactic, and universal leaderboards will come into being. Strive to get on those, for even the top million in the universe will receive great rewards. Achieve number one, and you will gain the opportunity for even greater power. Unfortunately, as part of the stipulations created by the ruler of this universe, Tantalos Viruvax, travel into other universes will be banned for as long as he is alive. Merchants and faction representatives can enter this universe, but none of you can leave. Finally, in 1 week, there will be a tournament among the inhabitants of this planet, creating opportunities for regional governance to those who place highly, and the vaunted ability to create a faction for the top three placers. The figure vanished, leaving the people standing there. Everything that they had just heard was like a revelation about their true place in the universe. Sam tried to count the people in the room, coming to the disheartening realization that there were nowhere near the number of people on Earth there. There were probably close to 10 million, but that was it. Over 99% of the population had died already. And that was good compared to the rest of the universe. Suddenly, the fact that aliens existed wasn't that crazy after all. The humans were left to talk for a few minutes, and then there was a flash of white light. Chapter 10. Sam found himself back in his cot. He got out of it and entered the front room. Jeffrey was still sleeping. Immediately, he was filled with suspicion. If Jeffrey had just been there at the system announcement, then why was he still asleep? A glint of something shiny was visible on his wrist, and Sam stealthily moved over. There was an intricately designed bracelet that shone with power to his vision. Making sure that Jeffrey wasn't awake, he took it off. A patch of orange started spreading from the wrist, and soon, the man was revealed not to be a human at all. He was some sort of bird-human hybrid, and he had a large coxcomb on his head. Jeffrey continued to sleep, oblivious to Sam's intrusion. Sam picked up the shotgun from next to Jeffrey and cocked it loudly. Jeffrey awoke with a start and saw that Sam was standing over him with the gun. "Hey, Sam. What? Why are you holding that gun?" "Cut the crap. Why were you concealing your appearance?" Jeffrey snorted as if to dispute what Sam had said. But then he noticed what had happened. "Oh. Shit," he said as he looked down at his skin. "Yeah. Now tell me what the hell you are before I send your ass back to KFC. Jeffrey sighed and sat back. "Are you sure?" "It's a long story." Sam sat down as well. "I have time to spare." "Fine. It all started a long time ago. I'm quite a bit older than I look. My family is from another universe, one that has been part of the system for much longer than this one. They were part of the ruling class in the Salvinier system, and I was the heir to my father's estate. Unfortunately, I was not the model noble that they were looking for. I was inclined to various depraved tendencies, most of which nobody cared about. However, I had a proclivity for going after women of all sorts, and eventually I made the mistake of trying to seduce the king's daughter. The problem was that she was already engaged. Her fiancé, a monstrous enlightened cultivator, dragged me in front of the king and made me confess to what had happened. To save my own skin and the reputation of my family, I chose exile. Not only from the Salvini system, that was too little for those bastards, but to a non-initialized universe. As a result, I went from the peak of F rank straight down to level 1-1. I knew that it was only a matter of time before this universe was initialized, and luckily, I retained my extended lifespan that my rank had given me. I adopted this persona of Jeffrey, and well, that's where I am now. Jeffrey stopped talking, letting Sam digest his words. Well, he sighed, you haven't done anything that makes me not want to trust you, other than the concealment, and I understand the reasons. As long as there aren't any other hidden bombshells, then you can remain with me. There will be a price to pay, though. Jeffrey nodded eagerly. Name it, and I will pay it if it is within my means. I want you to tell me more about how the system works. Jeffrey raised his eyebrows in surprise. That's it? Oh, you really don't know anything about it. I am still used to my old universe. Sorry. Sam nodded to hurry the man along. Well, where to begin? I should probably start off with the next thing of import that you will have to deal with. At level 25, you gain a class. You have a choice between three different options. The first one is based on your personal experiences. The second one is also based on your experiences, but on a different one. And the third one is system battery. That last one is only visible for the first class selection process, after which another normal option is unlocked. System battery? What's that? Jeffrey laughed. The system is very aggressive when it comes to expanding its power. The system battery class is one that seems good on the outside, but it's really a thinly veiled trap. You gain what is essentially unlimited mana, hence the name. But all of it is inaccessible to you, and you merely act as a recycler to channel the affinities out of the mana and back into the universe. The system is unable to process anything other than pure mana, so it uses these batteries to do so. In addition, you turn into a vegetative blob, incapable of complex thought or movement. Because of this, the system only gives it as a choice to the weakest of cultivators, the newly initialized, so as not to waste ones who have the potential to reach the second class selection process. It would be very unlikely that someone who had reached that stage, while already having encountered that class, would end up picking it, but the system is a bit paranoid, I guess. Why the hell would anyone pick that class? Jeffrey shrugged. Some people are just idiots. The system uses this fancy language to disguise the true nature of the class, and some people don't read past the first line, which of course says that you gain unlimited mana. That is akin to the juiciest of baits for new cultivators. Then, there are the zealots. I wouldn't expect there to be any in this universe, but in the higher ones like my own, the influence of the Grand Unified Church of the Sacred System can be felt. Sam snorted at this. What kind of ridiculous name is that? It sounds like something a scam company would call itself. Jeffrey laughed. Hit it right on the head on the nail. That's exactly what it is. I would be careful about who you said that to, though. If any of those maniacs heard that, then they would lead a purge of both you and your home planet. Oof. Well, I gotta be careful then. How did things like that happen, though? I would have expected something like that to have had widespread resistance against it. Ah, the idealistic attitude of the newly initialized. All that matters in the cultivating world is power. The reason that there aren't any resistance movements is that they have all been purged, and the few ones that do exist are too small to have heard of. Sam's Tao started to pulse to the wild beat of a battle hymn. His mind filled with righteous anger, and his gaze must have unsettled Jeffrey because the man flinched. Everything all right there, Sam? You look disturbed. It was nothing. Just my Tao responding to what you told me. Jeffrey choked. You already have a Tao. But it's been less than 2 days since the system came. It normally takes months for someone to make a Tao. Only the greatest of prodigies can make one in any less time. I've never heard of anyone, let alone someone new to the system, getting one so quickly.
Sam clapped his hand to his mouth, but it was too late.
At least he hadn't mentioned the mark.
Jeffrey looked at him, and the birdman raised a placating hand.
It's fine. I won't tell anyone. Just remember me when you're the ruler of the universe, okay?
Sam laughed at the ridiculous statement.
What?
That Tantalos guy is the ruler of the universe, not me.
I think you're making a big deal about nothing.
Jeffrey shook his head solemnly.
No, I'm not.
Tell me, did you get a title for gaining your Tao so early?
Sam nodded.
How much power does it give you?
Or if you don't want to tell me that, is it over mythical rarity?
Sam shrugged. I have no idea what the rarities are.
It's celestial, whatever that means.
Jeffrey fell off the edge of his bed. Sam walked over to check on him. The man was foaming at the mouth. He slapped him a few times, and he got up.
Are you all right?
How is that even possible?
That sort of rarity is like a myth.
Nobody in my system ever had even a mythical rarity title, except for the king. And that was only a temporary one.
Celestial rarity is something that only ascendants have.
Sure. It really doesn't seem that special to me.
Open your system and tell me what kind of stats you have, then we'll see if it's special or not.
Sam complied, opening his interface.
Sam Atlas, Human Mortal Tier G Rank Class, Nun Level 9. 6 stat points, unspent. Strength 22, 1.325x. Constitution 16, 1.325x. Resilience 15, 1.3. Intelligence 12, 132, 5x. Wisdom 15, 1.325x. Health 160, 160, 121. 2020 stamina. 222. 120 Dao. 1 skills. 3 titles. 1 temporary titles. 2 marks.
1.
Surprised at their new level. He hadn't really had a chance to test the effects of his title yet, but it seemed good.
How many total stat points do you have?
Jeffrey asked.
Wait a sec.
Okay. I have 92 points plus 6 unspent ones.
Jeffrey whistled.
Yep, I.
That confirms it.
That is way more points than someone at your level should have. You should only have about 55 to 65, accounting for your original stats. You're going to be a monster when you get more powerful.
Chapter 11. Sam let out a tentative smile.
First things first, Jeffrey continued, we need to get some levels into you. Losing your advantage that you currently have would be criminal. If I'm not mistaken, the first of the stronger enemies should be coming. You will get more levels from them.
Jeffrey took out his shotgun and checked it.
It was already loaded from when Sam had it.
Beckoning to Sam and Rax, he started to walk out the door.
Oh, now that the cat's out of the bag, I might as well join your party.
Why didn't you before?
Sam asked. Being in a party overrides any sort of identity concealment device. It would have told you who I really was. Sam added Jeffrey to the party and took a look at the display. He was very interested in what he would see.
Party 2, Torcherna Salvaniti Briscon. Level 8. Health 180, 180 racks. Level 7. Health 150, 150.
What kind of name is that?
Torcherna.
It sounds like some sort of knockoff pasta brand.
Jeffrey grimaced.
Look, I didn't make fun of your name. In my language, Sam is an acronym for a certain sensitive ailment that afflicts those who frequent establishments of ill repute.
Sam stared at him blankly.
Establishments that mainly operate at night.
What? You mean a bar?
My name means cirrhosis in your language?
Jeffrey sighed.
Let's just go with that.
Sam was very confused by the roundabout way that Jeffrey had described what he was getting at, but he forgot about it as they sighted their first monster. This creature was far larger than the gremlins, and it was quite disturbing. Two nubs of flesh were in the place of the creature's eyes, and the rest of its face was completely blank. It was shaped like a person, but it had three spider-like legs, and when it reared up to hiss at them, it revealed that it had a gaping, fang-lined orifice on the end of each of those legs. Sam gawked at the thing in horror. It was like something out of a nightmare. He sent off a quick analysis at it to see what he was dealing with. Juvenile chimera level 11. It was of a higher level than the members of the party, but his Dao skill would even the odds as well as his titles. He was already far ahead of the curve when it came to personal power. That was why he was high up on the power leaderboard, but not on the levels 1. There had been another 990 names under the top 10, but he hadn't bothered checking it for his name. Most of the people on it were around level 10. Which meant that the top people must have done something special to get there. He wanted to get access to whatever they were doing to grow so strong. With a start, he realized that if he hadn't killed Lena, she would have been near the top of the level's leaderboard. That realization disturbed him. What if the only way to get levels efficiently was to kill humans? He was surprisingly fine with killing now. Before, he would never have dreamed of it. Fighting for one's life had strange effects on the human psyche. He would not stoop to the level of killing innocents, though. He would only kill those who were truly evil, or if there was no other choice. The chimera hissed at them as they approached it, although Sam could tell where the noise was coming from on the creature's body. Because it lacked a mouth, the sound seemed to be created deep inside its body and sent out through its hand openings. It leaped forwards on its legs and landed in front of them. One went towards Sam, the other went towards Jeffrey, and the third one was used to balance. This allowed Rex to flank the creature, and he bit into its flesh, but did little damage on account of how tough its skin was. Sam fended off the hand and used Eyes of Judgment on the creature. It glowed with a black miasma of sin, and he felt a new strength course through his veins. Sam reached out and grabbed the hand of the chimera, pulling it towards him. The thing hissed again and abandoned its attack on Jeffrey, choosing instead to bite at Sam. He ignored the small wounds that the gnashing teeth caused, and instead used his machete to sever the arm of the chimera. It lurched backwards in shock, and he closed in on it, bisecting the other arm. With blood spurting from its body, the chimera let out a horrific, ululating cry. Thinking that this marked its defeat, Sam withdrew, but instead a noise started to grow in the distance. The sound of breaking wood and snapping branches started to approach them from the north. The chimera limped off to the side of the clearing where it expired from blood loss. Sam barely registered this, instead focused on what was coming from the woods. Jeffrey cowered beside him with his shotgun cradled affectionately. The cracking noise reached a crescendo, and a massive creature barreled through the trees and into the clearing. It had eight spider-like legs and a tiny fleshy body. Three massive tentacles extended from its gaping maw and dragged on the ground as if it was tasting it. Upon seeing the body of the chimera, it let out a rage-filled roar and charged the party. Jeffrey squealed and ran to the side, only to be picked up by one of the questing tentacles. Sam rushed to the beast and tore at it with his machete, but its skin was incredibly tough. Jeffrey screamed as the monster dangled him over its mouth, and it began to lower him slowly down into it. Sam checked his mana and saw that he didn't have enough to use his skill again. This would just have to be him against the beast. He had already allocated his stat points before they had left,
and he now had increased strength and resilience as a result. One of the tentacles blurred through the air and slammed into him, but he held on tightly and refused to let go. Like he was an annoying tick, the beast tried to dislodge him, but all that it did was split its attention enough for Jeffrey to gain the vantage for a perfect shot. Unloading the contents of his gun, he fired directly into one of the creature's eyes, bursting the watery orb and causing the monster to screech in pain. Sam pushed off the tentacle and climbed up the body of the creature towards its head. It glared at him with its one remaining eye and opened its mouth. The sounds of churning liquid started up, and Sam's eyes widened. He ducked down, narrowly avoiding a spray of stomach contents. Sparing a glance behind him, the vomit had started melting the grass and trees. It was highly acidic and would have melted his flesh off of his bones if he didn't watch out. He continued climbing the creature, and he reached its head, dodging another flailing tentacle. Jeffrey seemed to have been abandoned, in favor of him, and he saw the birdman crawling along the ground into the trees. He redirected the force of the tentacle into propulsion for a mighty leap, and he landed on the monster's head. With a cry, he sunk his machete deep into its other eye. Still, it was not dead, and he continued to stab at it. Anguished cries came from the creature as he completed his bloody work, and it lashed out with its tentacles at him. One of them caught him on his leg, and he felt a dull crack. Hopped up on adrenaline as he was, he barely felt it. His blade cut deeper and deeper into the flesh of the monster, and eventually it hit something hard. Gritting his teeth in disgust, Sam reached his hand down into the pulped eye matter and stabbed directly into the creature's brain. It swayed for a moment and then fell bodily to the ground. He jumped off it, but landed on his broken leg. A bright flash of pain consumed him, and he blacked out for a moment. When he came to, his leg was still sore, but was not broken. "You have killed a juvenile chimera. You have killed a mature chimera. You have leveled up." Al Sardinacarnia. Chapter 12. The shot of healing energy from a triple level up was enough to heal his leg enough to walk on, and he gingerly put weight on the limb. "Jeffrey," he called out to gain the attention of the other man. Rax padded over to him and pawed at his leg with his front limbs. The beast had largely been unharmed by the chimeras, as they didn't see him as a threat. He was a bit bigger now, though, and Sam checked the party link to see if he had leveled up. "Party, 2 Torturna Salvaniti Briskin, level 10 Toidai. Health, 190, Rax, level 9 Tarduar. Health, 170. Both of the others had only gained 2 levels from that fight. Perhaps a party didn't share levels equally, but more of them went to the person who actually killed the monster. Jeffrey was still nowhere to be seen, so Sam allocated his points. Not wanting to pull up his full status sheet every time that he leveled up, Sam imagined only seeing the table with his stats on it. To his surprise, it worked. Level 12. 6 stat points unspent. Strength 26, 142. 5x constitution 16, 1.325x. Resilience 19, 1.325x dex. 205, 1.325x. Looking at his stat distribution, Sam was happy with where his strength and resilience were. What he really needed now was more health and more speed. He knew that he would have to invest in the mental stats later, but for now his titles had increased them naturally. He evenly split the points between dexterity and constitution, nodding happily as his bonuses increased the points to 4. Now, he had 200 health and the speed of an Olympic sprinter. After the effects of the level ceased, he tested out his new power. He knew that his strength was high now, but he craved the feeling of speed that the dexterity would give. His feet flashed over the ground as he ran, and he looped the clearing multiple times in the time that it would normally take to go once. Finally, when he had finished, Jeffrey came back.
There you are.
Where were you?
Sam asked the man as he entered his line of sight.
That damn beast broke my arm.
Luckily, you killed it, or I wouldn't have healed.
That thing was a lot stronger than creatures in this area should have been, though.
It must have been at least level 16, on account of its size and toughness.
Its size has something to do with level?
Sam asked.
Yeah, a lot of monsters gain mass when they put their points into their physical stats. Only dexterity or mental-based ones remain the normal size.
Haven't you noticed that Rax has been growing too?
Sam nodded.
He had noticed that.
Would the Herpetopity eventually be the size of that Chimera?
Sam had a brief vision of a planet-sized Rax curling around Earth.
He laughed at the thought.
If you both reach the top of the Enlightened tier, that might not be so unrealistic,
Jeffrey said.
Sam had forgotten about how party members could hear his thoughts when he was in it.
They left the clearing and continued walking.
They wanted to find somewhere where there were more people.
Not to join up with them, Sam had no intention of exposing himself as the arbiter, but he hoped that there would be items for sale there.
The system had said something about how merchants could enter the universe, and perhaps there would be one of them at the nearest population center.
Maybe he could ask them for more information.
Jeffrey had provided quite a lot, but most of it was irrelevant to his life in this universe.
The Chicken Man could write a dissertation on the subject of Rathnarian perfumers, but that was completely useless to survival.
Sure, he knew a decent bit about the system, but it wasn't anything groundbreaking.
The coating of Chimera blood on Sam must have scared off the monsters in the woods because they were not attacked by another monster for the entire duration of their trip. Eventually, after hours of walking, a strange sight appeared.
A beam of white light extended into the sky from a point behind the trees and illuminated the dusk sky.
They made their way to it cautiously, not sure if it was an enemy or a potential ally.
As they edged their way through the woods, they could make out what it was.
A mile-wide patch of trees had been removed from the forest, and in their place, a shimmering dome of light was visible. Every now and again, monsters would slam into it, recoiling with flashes of light and a faint smell of burnt flesh.
Inside the dome, they could see people moving about.
Some were human, but there were a few that were totally alien in appearance.
A gateway stood on the opposite side of the clearing, and a set of turrets dissuaded any monsters from coming near.
Every now and again, a party of people would walk through the gates and into the area.
"I think we should go in there," Sam whispered.
Jeffrey nodded.
They slunk around the edge of the clearing and approached the gateway.
The turrets pointed at Rax briefly, but they seemed to realize that he was part of their group.
The turrets pointed the other way, and the gate opened slowly.
They walked in and immediately felt the difference.
The air inside was much warmer than the air outside, and they could see why.
Many cacti and palm trees lined the streets, but they were unearthly plants, most of a shade of deep red.
People walked along the street, most of them clad in armor of some kind.
Sam felt vulnerable in comparison to them, in his dirty overalls and shirt.
Street hawkers called out their wares in strange accented voices.
There were few humans working the stalls, and most of the workers were aliens.
Above each stall, a different emblem was visible, and they all would call out a name now and again.
Buy from the new Barkuya Trading Company.
Best wares in the galaxy, by Trahonia.
They sounded like a typical market square, busy with vendors and patrons.
The goods were not normal, though.
As Sam eagerly eyed up the exotic-looking wares, he realized with a sinking heart that he had no money.
Chapter 13. Hey, Jeffrey?
I don't have anything to buy stuff with.
I doubt
They take dollars.
Jeffrey looked at him in surprise.
You never checked out your credit balance?
What?
Tap your left wrist 3 times, and it will come up.
Sam followed his instructions, and a small screen popped up.
Credit balance, 7,450.
Where did this come from?
He said in shock.
The system implanted it in you when you were having your core created.
It allows you to collect money from certain monsters and people that you kill.
Is 7,450 a lot or a little?
Jeffrey shrugged.
Back where I came from, it was nothing, but in a newly initialized universe, you could probably get some good stuff.
You shouldn't have that much, though, unless you were killing a lot more monsters that I saw.
Sam thought about where the credits had come from before he realized.
Oh, that's why.
I killed this woman who had killed hundreds of people. She told me that it was just for the levels, but she was probably in it for the cash as well. I must have gained her credits when I killed her.
If she was as flagrant a murderer as you said, perhaps someone placed a bounty on her?
Where do I find bounties?
Sam asked.
In a town like this, they probably have a local division of the Bounty Hunter Guild.
If someone left a bounty, then they will reward you for it.
They searched the town for the building and eventually found it.
Tucked away in a small alleyway, the door to the guild was ajar.
They walked in and into a different world.
Sunburnt men and women, wearing utilitarian clothes of a drab color, aliens with strange guns strapped to their belts. It was like a scene out of a sci-fi movie.
At the very front of the building, a large hologram of a board was visible.
On it, there were a list of names next to a credit number.
He surveyed the top 10 and found something very disturbing.
1. The Arbiter, 100,000 credits. There was a bounty on his head, and it was a lot of money. He was so glad that he had made a fake name for the leaderboards, or he would probably have been dead by now.
Jeffrey saw it too, but he wisely concealed his reaction.
He read down the list and looked for Lena Scarlet.
The other top 10 people were the people on the overall power list, with the ones under it people that he had never heard of.
Lena Scarlet was in the 153rd place with a bounty of 5,000 credits.
Sam walked up to the board and tried to figure out how to claim the bounty.
A person stood behind the desk, a green alien with prodigious tusks and an underbite.
Sam immediately thought orc.
When he scanned the man, however, it said that he was actually a Truvarian.
It was only a coincidence that he looked like an orc.
Still, Sam decided to refer to them as orcs. It was less of a mouthful.
Oi! What the hell do you think you're doing?
The orc called out.
Scanning me without me permission.
The orc even spoke exactly like Sam had expected. Sam winced. He had not intended to offend the orc.
Sorry. I just wanted to know what species you were. You look like something I've seen before.
That was the wrong response.
The orc puffed up in rage and started to scream.
Filthy human. I'm gonna cave your skull in.
Let me guess, all Truvarians look alike to you?
Goddamn racist.
Whoa, that's not what I meant.
Look. I'm sorry.
I was just curious, that's all.
Multiple people were staring to stare over at them by now, and he could see a few people edging their way over.
This pinky causing you trouble, Erg?
Another orc said as he walked up, glaring at Sam.
Asshole scanned me without me telling him he could.
I ought to teach him a lesson.
So should I, Erg, but we can't.
He's a freshie, so we're not allowed to attack him.
System rules.
The orc sighed and stormed off.
The new orc continued to glare at Sam.
Now look what you've done.
Gone and upset Erg, that's what.
Sam groaned,
This was not what he had expected coming in here.
I came here to collect a bounty
on Lena Scarlet. I killed her a day ago, but I don't know how to claim it. Upon hearing that he was here on business, the orc softened a bit.
All right.
Just place your hand on this scanner, and it will detect if you possess any remnants of her essence. The orc pulled out a circular metal device and placed it on the table. A hologram of Lena Scarlet appeared over it, and Sam placed his hand down. The scanner beeped and went green, and he received a system notification. You have received 5,000 credits. The orc nodded at Sam and walked off to the back of the shop. The unfriendly looks that he was getting, especially from the orcs in the area, ushered him out rapidly. He made his way over to Jeffrey, who was shivering.
Come on, Mian, Amivius,
let's get out of here.
After they left the shop, Jeffrey let out a deep breath. You really have a knack for trouble, don't you?
We would both have been smears on the ground if you weren't new to the system. Those Orsies were both F rank.
F rank?
Why are they here then?
They were part of the Bounty Hunters Guild. They were here as representatives. Most guilds and sects want to get a foothold in new universes, even if they are just going to be eliminated eventually by someone like Tantalos Veruvak. Also, you should look into him. I've never heard of the man before, but he seems to be strong. A merchant might sell some information packages if you're lucky.
Look, there's one right now.
Jeffrey pointed at a tent that was manned by a purple humanoid with four arms. They walked over and Sam began to talk.
Hey, what are you selling?
I have some credits to burn. The vendor snapped his fingers and a system display appeared in front of Sam. G-rank healing crystal, 500 credits small G-rank essence crystal, 750 credits system guide, 1,000 credits dodge, common skill, 1,500 credits factions of the multiverse, 2,500 credits medium G-rank. Weapon knowledge, uncommon skill, 7,500 credits large G-rank essence crystal, 10,000 credits Dao guide, 50,000 credits. Sam perused the list of wares, stopping when he saw how expensive the Dao guide was.
Hey, why does the Dao guide cost that much?
I only have a few copies of it.
The system doesn't like that sort of information getting out to people who haven't worked to get it, the purple alien replied.
Would you be interested in my other goods, though?
Yeah, where can I find out more about Tantalos Veruvax?
The other man shivered at the name.
I'm not sure if I can help you there.
If he somehow catches word, then I will be hunted down.
Actually, I should get going now.
I left the, stove on back at home. The merchant had suddenly become incredibly nervous.
Just help me out on this one.
I will pay extra, if you want.
The merchant was still reluctant, but when he heard how many credits Sam had, he became less so.
I can add on the information to the Factions of the Multiverse guide for an additional 10,000 credits.
10,000?
The information can't be that dangerous.
The most I'll do is 5,000, and I want you to throw in the system guide as well.
The vendor vacillated for a moment before he sighed and acquiesced.
Fine, I'll do it.
In all actuality, the man was probably getting a great deal, but Sam didn't mind that much.
You are being requested to transfer 7,500 credits in exchange for system guide and factions of the multiverse.
Accept?
Young Sam hit yes, and the money was sent from his credit balance and into the other man's. Two crystals appeared in his hands, and he placed them in his pocket. He was about to thank the mechant,
but the purple-skinned man had already packed up and left somehow.
Chapter 14. Ha! Huh, that was some smooth bargaining, Jeffrey said.
Almost as good as my great Uncle Thalen.
That man could cut the costs of interplanetary tariffs by half. Anyway, I see a certain food stand that is calling my name.
Why don't you go and absorb those information crystals?
Before Sam could answer, Jeffrey was already gone, speedwalking towards an unmarked building. With a swish, he opened the door and was inside. It did not look like a food stall to Sam. He had more important things to do, though, and he walked over to a bench to sit at and use the crystals. Rex followed him over, and the herpetope sat down by the seat on the ground. The creature had gotten a few looks on the way, but he was far from the most exotic beast either. A lot of the aliens had their own pets of wildly varying types, and a couple of the humans had their own monsters as well. Rex was a lot bigger than most of them, though, except for a pig-like monster with six legs that followed an orc around. It was about the size of a minivan, and it looked as if it could break through an iron wall with its massive tusks. Strangely, none of the creatures seemed to be aggressive, and they all placidly trotted along. Sam realized that Rex hadn't spoken to him since they entered the town, and he checked on him.
Rex? You all right? Sam? Well, where am I? Everything is so blurry.
What? Is there something in the air? Sam asked, but Rex did not respond. The monster didn't look like he was in pain or anything, merely tired. He left Raxby and picked up his crystals. The first one that he wanted to use was the system guide. Remembering how he had used the health crystal, he crushed the thing in his hand, and a burst of information entered his brain. It displayed itself like a rolling wall of text, and he took it in. System Guide, Basic Edition Section 1, Stat Section 2, Classes Section 3, Leveling Up Section 4, Party Section 5. Rank Sam selected the first entry and more information came up. The stats are one of the most important things in the life of a system user. They are quantified notations of the user's physical and mental parameters. Strength influences lifting capacity, physical output, and stamina dot dot. Dexterity influences physical speed and reaction time, as well as agility. Constitution influences the amount of damage that the user can take before death, as well as health. Resilience influences the physical durability of the user and how much power is required to damage them. Intelligence influences mental processing power, memory, and the ability to multitask, as well as mana capacity. Wisdom increases one's ability to detect traps, anomalies, and to succeed in their pursuit of higher ideals, such as the Tao. All of that was exactly as Sam had expected, except for the last one. Wisdom had seemed like a useless stat to Sam, but now he saw that if he pumped it, then he could potentially develop his day more quickly. It was a balance, though, as doing so wouldn't give him any tangible benefits in the meantime. He opened the next entry, the one on classes. A class is a tool that a system user can use in order to gain power more quickly, as well as to gain more powerful skills. Upon level 25, the accumulated potential of the user grants them the ability to dedicate their journey to a specific path. Upon reaching the rank, there are three choices given. Two of them are based on one's personal accomplishments and ideals, whereas the last one is a noble path that only the bravest of souls take. One who takes the system battery class is among the more pure and selfless of the inhabitants of the multiverse, and in return they gain limitless mana. Sam could see what Jeffrey had meant. If not for his advice, Sam might well have been tricked into picking the system battery class. It seemed as if the system had written this guide because of the way that it described it. Likely, it also prevented information about the class from being spread freely. Laughing at how dishonest the description was, he continued to read. Upon defeating an opponent, or in certain cases, breaking through in your knowledge of crafting, a system user can direct this energy to leveling up. Leveling up grants the user an amount of power to direct towards improving their stats. Every rank you have the opportunity to upgrade your class. The amount of stats that you gain per level is based on your rank and your class. So that was why he was only getting 2 points per level. It had seemed pretty low to him, but it would probably become exponentially higher in the future. The next informational segment was on parties. You can form a party with up to 4 other members. Be sure that they are trustworthy, for nothing can be hidden within a party. The minds of the members are connected, making it trivial for a telepath to intrude upon one's innermost thoughts. To combat this, entering a party overrides any sort of identity concealment device that one might possess. So, do not create a party lightly. The members share essence from monsters on a ration based on their contribution. There is a minimum amount that one can receive, so be careful about those who would seek to profit off of your hard work. Finally, and the one that he was looking forward to the most, there were ranks. Ian wanted to know what exactly G rank had meant. Every set interval of levels, one must complete a trial to reach the next rank. Ranks are divided into 4 tiers. Firstly, there is the mortal tier. Those within this are of the G and F ranks. A level 1 system user is the same in power as a non-initialized being. Next, there is the enlightened tier. Beings within the E and D ranks are in this tier. Thirdly, there's the ascendant tier. This is made up of C and B rank, 1A. Finally, there is the divine tier. This is solely reserved for ranks. Each jump in rank grants a large increase in power, and each jump in tier increases it even more. The information on the ranks was pretty sparse, and Sam had already surmised as much from seeing that the ranks were organized by letter and from listening to Jeffrey. All in all, the information had been quite useful, and he was glad that he had picked it up. Before he could break into the package about the multiversal factions, a loud noise came from the building that Jeffrey had come out of. "That was my wife, you goddamn chicken!" A burly human screamed as he threw Jeffrey bodily out of the window in a spray of glass shards. He scurried over to Sam, and the man followed him with his angry gaze. "If you ever come back here, I'll gut you," the angry man said with a raised fist. Sam stared at Jeffrey. What was all that about? Jeffrey squirmed. It was dark. You humans all look alike. How was I supposed to know that she wasn't one of the workers? Sam facepalmed. "Please don't tell me that was a brothel," he said in exasperation. "I'm afraid it was." Sam grimaced. If this caused problems for him later, he was going to have some serious words with Jeffrey. They found a room for the night, and Sam found himself thinking about the massive bounty on his head. Eventually, he was able to fall asleep, but it took a lot of effort. Chapter 15. The number 2 and number 3 strongest humans on Earth sat on opposite sides of a table. Both of them were from the U.S., and they were currently situated at a derelict hospital in New York. After the system had created the leaderboards, they had decided to find each other. Rodney Kane was the one who had sought out Andrew Monroe, the self-styled scourge of New York. As Rodney sipped on a glass of whiskey that had been recovered from a mostly intact bar, he listened to what Andrew had to say. "My sources tell me that the Arbiter is currently in the States as well. After we put up the bounty for him, as expected, a lot of false reports came in. Those people were dealt with, but a few of them had promise. In Outpost 78, one of the towns that the aliens set up, someone reported that a man was seen looking intently at the bounty listing for the Arbiter. That on its own was nothing special. 100,000 credits is a lot of money. But he then collected the bounty for Lena Scarlet, a well-known human hunter. She was infamous for almost wiping out her town in search of levels, and if not for her untimely death, she would have been on the leaderboards by now. The fact that the man was able to defeat her means that he is quite powerful, and even if he is not the one we seek, he could be valuable. Rodney listened intently to the other man's story. He knew the importance of details. After all, those were what had led to his imprisonment for 10 long years. He had been the leader of a massive criminal organization, spanning multiple states, and he had been put away because he had forgotten to change his shirt the day after a particularly vicious heist. Such a small thing had led to one of the detectives on his trail finding out who he was. He remembered her screams as he had exacted his revenge on her. The woman had lost her opportunity to level up by deciding to protect a group of survivors from the gremlins. Weak from the exertion, she had been helpless against him. The fact that he was over 5 levels higher than her had helped as well. He smiled absently as he remembered wreaking havoc upon the entire institution that had put him away. There was no trace of the district court that had imprisoned him, nor was there one of the prison that he had been put in. Ironically, it was his imprisonment that had led to him being able to become so powerful. He had been placed into a low-level prison for white-collar crime, and when the system came, he had utilized his murderous talent to kill every single inmate there. When the gremlins broke in, he had slaughtered them utterly. On the other hand, Andrew Monroe had been a high-level government official before the arrival of the system. He would not say what exactly his job had been, but he was just as ruthless and dangerous as his companion. Their goal was to create a new order for planet Earth, and the first step was getting rid of the competition. In various places across planet Earth, Phoenix, also known as Laratoth, sped over the cracked cobblestones of the historical district of London. When the system came, she had been an employee at a dog daycare establishment. The advent of the system had led to her gaining a special skill, one that gave her great aptitude for the taming of beasts. With her army of high-level dogs, she had swept through the city like a storm, gathering survivors and creating an army to withstand the onslaught. Like Rodney Kane and Andrew Monroe, she too wanted nothing more than to find the Arbiter. If not to eliminate him, to discover how to create her own Deo. Melissa Tang trekked through the snowy wastes of the far north. She had lived in Yellowknife before the arrival of the system, and had been far away from the center of the city when the monsters arrived. She had later discovered that more monsters spawned in greater areas of concentration, causing her to leave her city for the safety of the wilderness. With a canny instinct for survival, and a host of high-end hunting equipment ransacked from an outfitter, she had made her own kingdom up in the frigid cold, one forged on the corpses of 1,000 monsters. With a few survivors at her side, as well as a near-sapient polar bear that she had named Sweetie, they eked out a passable existence there. In the most shadowy recesses of the Vatican, the Angel of Death sat in silence. He had been the mysterious head of the exorcism branch of the Catholic Church, and as it turned out, banishing demons translated well to killing monsters. In a warped version of the original faith, he and his followers had created the Church of Scouring Flame, one dedicated to the eradication of all things demonic and profane. He had a real name, but this current one suited him well as it encapsulated his purpose perfectly. On the highest peak in the Himalayas, the man known as Profound Visionary sat. Since the advent of the system, all he had done was contemplate the new order of the universe and his place in it. His followers had brought him a steady stream of monsters to kill, and he had gratefully partaken. Once the abbot of a secluded monastery, he was now seen as the living incarnation of the Buddha. Utilizing a lifetime spent in silent contemplation, He was the closest to forming a Tao out of anyone living on Earth save Sam. Elminster Judge, the man who had made peace with the monsters, sat in the middle of a gremlin den. Before the system had come, he had been in a mental institution, sent there for his delusional schizophrenia. When the first monster came into his room, he had thought it yet another figment of his imagination and had simply ignored it. When it started to devour him, he ignored it. After a while, the gremlin realized that this human was different. Through the mysterious processes in which a monster digested human flesh, the gremlin had been instilled with a spark of sapience, but also madness too. With the help of his new friend, Elminster Judge had created a vast army of monsters that helped him cement his position in the region. Finally, the person known as Anonymous sat at the very top of the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world. The monsters had thrown themselves at the door of the building for hours on end, but when they left, the true monsters were revealed. Clad in a blank white mask, Anonymous had slaughtered their way down the building, cleansing it of any semblance of life save their own. Now Anonymous waited for the monsters to leave so that they could bring their gifts to the rest of the world.